Commander Kelly, what a thrill it is to be speaking to you. As you travel at a rate of 5 miles per second, I understand 200 miles above us, getting close to finishing a year in space. First question, how are you doing? What has surprised you most about any changes in your health?
Well, I'm doing pretty good. I do feel like I've been up here for a really long time, and I look forward to getting home soon. What surprised me from a health perspective? You know, a lot of the research we do is imagery based. Just this morning I was doing some ultrasound exams on my eyes and my heart, and a lot of that data is stuff that'll be analyzed, by the scientists and researchers, and it'll take time, probably well after I'm back before we have results. But from a kind of a subjective perspective, I don't really have any surprises. I, you know, kind of knew what to expect going into this because I had flown a long duration flight before. So, there's been a little, effects on my vision, which I had last time. But overall, nothing alarming.
Gravitational waves have been found, proving yet another one of Einstein's theories correct. Another one of his theories has to do with the space-time continuum, which would dictate that you're actually aging more slowly than your twin brother Mark here is on Earth. Obviously, it's a minuscule difference, but I'm curious, does it feel different time-wise? Does time change for you in some way being up there?
So because we're in this environment that's like a laboratory in many ways, in some ways it's kind of like a submarine or a ship, but one in which you cannot leave, and one in which, I'm at work when I go to sleep, I'm at work when I wake up. I've been here since March. It's not like the days seem to go by slower, but definitely the whole period of time has, it seems like a long time. A year now seems longer than I thought it would be. And so I definitely have an appreciation for, certain things that that freedom and, being on Earth provide. But, certainly, being confined for this period of time is not something that I think people would it's different when you're in space and you're doing something that thinks is important. But I would relish my freedom more after this experience maybe than I did before.
Everyone is fascinated with this, with space, and everyone is certainly fascinated with the views that you have. You get to look back on Earth. If Earth were a human body and you were looking at it, how does it look? Does Earth look sick? Does it look healthy? How would you describe it?
So there are definitely parts of, Asia, Central America, that when you look at them from space, you're always looking through a haze of pollution. So, but, the Earth is covered by, a lot of other land masses and water. It's surprising, how much water is out there. So as far as the atmosphere is concerned and being able to see the surface, I'd say definitely those areas that I mentioned look, kind of sick, like you said. You definitely notice weather systems at times that aren't really expected to be, where they are. For instance, like tropical cyclones in certain parts of the world at times that you don't expect them, or other, weather conditions. When you look at the atmosphere, I wouldn't say it looks, the thin veil of the atmosphere on the limb of the Earth, I wouldn't say it looks unhealthy, but it definitely looks very, very fragile and, just kind of like this thin film. So it looks like something that we definitely need to take care of.
I also wanted to ask you a question about the political cycle here, but I thought I'd do it in a slightly different way. We have a series of debates coming up here on CNN, and I want to give you the floor for a second, Commander, to ask a question of our next president, what would you ask?
You know, I guess as an astronaut, a NASA astronaut, I would be, you know, I feel obligated to ask a space-related question, what their goals and their vision are for our space program. I think this, our history in space and the International Space Station and those other things we do have significant value to our economy, to who we are as a people, as a species, really. And, you know, I would want to know what their vision is for NASA and how, you know, they would plan to execute that vision.
I'm curious about your views on private space travel. There's been a lot of energy and money, frankly, around that industry lately. As someone who's done it, been up there, what do you think? Do you support it? Do you encourage it?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, this is an amazing experience. It's a fascinating place, not only for tourism, but our ability to, like I said, this is an incredibly complex facility. And by doing really hard things, we reap the benefits. And commercial space is hard. So by developing, those rockets and the systems to have more people visit and live in space for periods of time, there will be benefits to that. And, I'd like to see, someday where, like airline travel, where not everyone could afford it, but a lot of people could afford it. So it is something that I definitely feel very strongly about, and I think it's great that we have these companies that are pursuing this, because then it lets NASA, direct their energy and focus on, the frontier, the places that we haven't been to before, because, I think those are the kind of things that the government should be involved with, and I think something that NASA does very well. So it's, I think it's a commercial space is a great thing.
One of the objectives for this mission, besides the twin study, was to look at how feasible a mission to Mars might be. If this were a mission to Mars, which takes 9 months or longer, you'd in fact just be getting started with that mission as opposed to getting near to the end. I'm curious, with all that you've learned, all you've seen, do you think Mars is feasible? And also, when we eventually maybe get there, do you think that there's extraterrestrial life there or other places?
Yeah, I think it's definitely feasible. I think there are certain challenges. The radiation environment between the Earth and Mars is something that we're going to have to figure out, because there is we get protection here on the space station. Although we get a lot more radiation than you do on Earth, you'd get a much more on your way to Mars. So that's a challenge. The life support systems are, on one hand a challenge, but we've been maintaining these systems here for the last 15 years. Now, we can get resupply quicker, but there's a lot we've learned here from operating the space station that will help us go to Mars. I think the biggest challenge, though, is the public support and the financial support from our government or other governments to do this. Because I think technically, pretty much anything we've ever put our mind to, we've been able to accomplish. So I think the challenge is mostly from a public and government financial support. And as far as whether there's life there on Mars or whether there was actually ever life there, I don't know. it would be great to find out, though.
Commander Kelly, thank you so much for your time. Really appreciate it. Good luck up there. We'll talk to you soon.